Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 29th of October 2019, displayed at the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, Hyderabad and Trivandrum editions, the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. This news article is about a governance mission from the state of Karnataka. The news article also mentions that even the Prime Minister has shown special interest in this particular mission in order to look at the possibilities of using it at the national level. So this topic is important from preparation point of view. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. This news article talks about Sakala mission, which is for the guaranteed timely delivery of services. See, this mission is based on a state legislation, that is a law which has been passed by the state assembly of the state of Karnataka. The law name is called as the Karnataka Sakala Services Act of 2011. Earlier it was called as the Karnataka Guarantee of Services to Citizens Act of 2011. It came into force on 2nd April 2012. That is why the news article mentions that the Sakala mission started since April 2012. This act provides a guarantee of services to citizens within a stipulated time limit in Karnataka. This act talks about the right to service, that is right to obtain service within stipulated time limit as specified in the schedule of the act. The schedule of the act stipulates the time limit for delivery of various government services. This state act also provides for monitoring the status of the application, which brings in transparency, then the e-governance of services, that is delivering citizen services electronically. And this act also provides the means to appeal for the aggrieved citizens if a competent authority defaults or fails to deliver the services. Now, one of the most important provisions of this act is that the Section 8 of this act. See, this Section 8 states that in case of delay or if there is a default in the delivery of services beyond a particular time, that is beyond a stipulated time, then the citizen is statutorily entitled to seek compensatory cost. And the authority, whoever is the authority, if they fail to deliver the services within that particular time limit, then they are liable to pay the compensatory cost. And once the liability is fixed as per the procedure mentioned in the act, the defaulting authority is also liable for disciplinary action. So this act or this Sakala mission establishes accountability on the part of the government. So this act provides citizens a guarantee for delivery of citizen services within a stipulated time period. Thus, this act aims at bringing transparency, accountability and predictability to delivery of services to the citizens. So this particular mission is important from transparency, accountability point of view. And as per this news article, there are around some 301 services that comes under the Sakala mission. Also, this mission has disposed around 99.5% of the applications which have been received since its start, that is from April 2012 till October 2019. Now, the state government, that is the state government of Karnataka, has decided to make this mission online. Here, the purpose is to eliminate middlemen and also to achieve faceless, cashless and paperless service delivery. So this is the purpose beyond making this Sakala mission online. Now what about those people who do not possess the knowledge to apply online, or those people who may not have required smartphones or computers or even internet facility to apply online? For them, the government will bring Seva Sindhu Kendras. These Seva Sindhu Kendras will provide end-to-end online services for the 301 services from 43 different departments of the state government of Karnataka. These Kendras will also have the facilities to provide services with e-signature, and it will also have DigiLocker facility, that is the digital locker facility. Then the Karnataka state government has also introduced the concept of Janasevaka on a pilot basis. Here the term Janasevaka is the concept of service delivery. It refers to delivering services to citizens at their doorsteps. This is all about this Sakala mission. As we told, you can quote this particular mission for accountability and transparency. And also, in relation to timely delivery of services, either in your GS paper 2 or in your GS paper 4, if you want to quote an example whenever you're writing a case study. And if you see, at the national level, we do not have a legislation or an act similar to this Karnataka Sakala Services Act. In future, if there is such a legislation at the national level, this will bring a huge impact among the citizens in ensuring the timely delivery of all or the notified government services. Such a law is a necessity, as we are hearing allegations across the nation that the government services are not provided in a timely manner or in a predictable fashion. So introducing a scheme like Sakala scheme at the national level will help in ensuring transparent and timely delivery of services. And you can quote the scheme in GS paper 2 or in GS paper 4. If you remember, there was a question on Cyberdome, which is one of the state scheme, that is the state scheme of Kerala, which appeared in 2019 mains general studies paper 3. So this topic is also of equal relevance. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Next, let us see the data point which appears in the OPET column. This data point is based on the recently released Doing Business 2020 report by the World Bank. The syllabus that is relevant to the discussion is given here for your reference. Before seeing the data point, let us see in brief about this Doing Business 2020 report. This Doing Business 2020 report indicates the ease of doing business in a particular country during the year 2019. And the ease of doing business ranking is a part of this report. So as a part of this report, 190 economies have been ranked for the ease of doing business, and India has been ranked 63rd out of the 190 economies for the year 2019. Every year, World Bank releases this Doing Business report. This Doing Business 2020 report is the 17th such report which has been released by the World Bank. This report investigates the regulations that enhance the business activity and those regulations that constrain the business activity. So what are regulations? Regulations exist in order to protect the workers and in order to ensure the public safety, then to promote business and investments. But if that particular regulation, if it is inefficient or inadequate, then it can affect the entrepreneurial activity and it will further affect the business growth, and it will also impact the ease of doing business in that particular country. These regulations are because of excessive government intervention, or we can tell that as cumbersome red tape. These not only have an adverse impact on the individual businesses and investors, but it will also have an adverse impact on the economy's ability to grow sustainably, which means that there will not be sustainable growth in that particular country wherever there is a lot of red tape. So ineffective regulations are adverse to economic growth. Now let us discuss the basis of ranking the countries. This Doing Business 2020 report covers 12 areas of business regulation. If you see, the 12 areas of business activity are mentioned here, like starting a business, employing workers, dealing with construction permits, getting electricity, registering property, etc. Out of these 12 areas of business activity, only 10 are taken for ranking purpose. So two are left out. These two are employing workers and contracting with the government. So both these indicators are not included in the ease of doing business ranking. Please note this, because if you remember, there was a question in this year prelims examination about the sub indicators which are being calculated as a part of ease of doing business ranking. So sometimes you do get questions from such areas. So try to remember these 12 areas, especially the 10 areas based on which this ranking is being done. So apart from these two indicators, the remaining 10 indicators are used for calculating the ranking. These 10 indicators are used to calculate a score out of 100 for each country. Now based on the calculation, the countries have been ranked, and according to this report, the best places or the best countries in the world to do business are the countries of New Zealand, Singapore, Hong Kong, Denmark, US, etc. And note that India's score is 71 in this ranking. And one more thing which you need to know is that the score for India is calculated on the basis of the business activities that are being carried out in two cities, which are the cities of Mumbai and Delhi. And one more takeaway from this report is that India is among the top 10 countries which have improved the most in their ease of doing business score. The other countries are the countries of Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Pakistan, Kuwait, China, Nigeria, etc. Next, let us see a graph of India's ranking in the ease of doing business over the past 5 years. So, in this year ranking, India has been ranked 63rd. The previous year, that is in 2018, it was 77. And if you see in the year 2015, it was 142. So, you can see that year on year, India's ranking has seen an improvement. Now, you can use this graph in any of your mains answers. Now, let us come back to data point. We saw that India has been ranked 63rd out of the 190 economies. Though we have improved our ranking compared to the 2019 doing business report, where India was ranked 77, but still India's position is lower when compared to the other countries of BRICS, especially the countries of China and Russia, because China has been ranked 31 in this year's report and Russia has been ranked 28 in this year's report. But India has been ranked only 63rd. So we can see that India is lagging behind the countries of China and Russia amongst the BRICS grouping. So whenever you are trying to study about India's ranking in some important indices or in some important reports, then always try to make a comparison of India's ranking for the previous 5 years and also a comparison of India's ranking with certain global or regional groupings like BRICS. So this will give an edge when writing the mains answers. Now let's see the next picture. This picture shows the comparison of the 10 sub-indicators of doing business ranking, and the comparison is made between the present year's report, that is this year's report, and 2015 report. From this picture, you can tell that 8 out of the 10 indicators have shown improvement, but in 2 sub-indicators, India's ranking have dropped. One is protecting minority investors. If you see, this particular sub-indicator mainly measures the rights of minority shareholders in corporate governance and business transactions. And the other sub-indicator is registering property, where this sub-indicator mainly measures the procedures, time and cost to transfer a property and the quality of the land administration system. So India's ranking has dropped in both these sub-indicators. If you see in the 2020 report, India's ranked at 13 in protecting minority investors. And India's rank is 154 when it comes to registering property. So this report tells that despite a good ranking, corporate governance in India needs to be more transparent and it should be more open to the minority shareholders. And when it comes to registering a property, the number of procedures and the time delay need to be cut down. And also the land administration system needs to be improved. So this will place India at a better position in the overall ranking in the future. So these were some of the comments made by the World Bank in this report. So this is all about this second picture. Now let us move on to the third picture. The very intention behind this picture is that though the ease of doing business ranking shows that there is improvement in many indicators of doing business, but India's ranking has reduced in the Global Competitiveness Ranking 2019, which is released by the World Economic Forum. This is because certain indicators of this particular Global Competitiveness Ranking overlaps with the sub-indicators of ease of doing business ranking. And as per this Global Competitiveness Ranking 2019, India's rank has dropped 10 spots when compared with the previous year 2018. That is, in 2018, India was ranked 58th, but this year it has slipped to 68th rank out of 141 countries considered for this report. See, we have discussed about this Global Competitiveness Index 2019 in detail in our 10th October The Hindu News analysis. Please refer to that particular explanation to have a better understanding about Global Competitiveness Index 2019. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article talks about particularly vulnerable tribal group in the state of Telangana. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Know that based on 4 criteria, certain tribal groups are listed as particularly vulnerable tribal groups by the Ministry of Home Affairs One criteria is that the particular tribal group should be having a pre-agricultural level of technology. The second criteria is that that particular tribal group must be undergoing a stagnant population, or the population must be declining. And the next criteria is that there has to be extremely low literacy prevailing in that particular tribal group. And the final criteria is that the particular tribal group shall be having a subsistence level of economy. Here, when we say subsistence level of economy, it means the activity that is carried out by the tribal groups shall be in a minimum level, which will be useful only for the survival and the sustenance of the members of that particular tribal group. That means whatever they may produce, they may not be able to sell or earn profit at a large scale. Even though they may earn something, the earnings will be used for their survival purpose only and not for any other additional advancements. So based on the above four criteria, so far around 75 tribal groups from 18 states and one union territory have been notified as particularly vulnerable tribal groups by the Ministry of Home Affairs. The one union territory is the Union Territory of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now let us come back to the news article. This news article talks about two tribal groups in the state of Telangana. The two tribal groups that are mentioned in the news article are Kolam tribe and the Naikpot tribe. The news article mentions that both these tribal groups are particularly vulnerable tribal groups, but this fact is wrong. This is because so far around 12 tribal groups which are residing in the states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana were declared as particularly vulnerable tribal groups, and Naikpot tribal group is not one among them. This means Naikpot tribal group is not a particularly vulnerable tribal group, but know that they are listed as scheduled tribe in both the states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Now, if you see the Kolam tribal group, they are notified as particularly vulnerable tribal group in three states, which are Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, and in Maharashtra. And these tribal groups also reside in the states of Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, but in these states, they are not yet declared as particularly vulnerable tribal groups. And both these tribal groups are dependent on bamboo in forests in the Adilabad district and in other areas in the state of Telangana for their livelihood. We know that the Government of India has amended the definition of tree in the Indian Forest Act of 1927 in 2017-2018. Earlier, bamboo was also present in the definition of tree. Now it has been excluded. And know that taxonomically, bamboo is called as a grass. The government has clarified that the change in definition for bamboo applies only to the bamboo that is cultivated in the non-forest areas and not for the bamboos in the forest areas. So this amendment therefore has helped the bamboo cultivation in non-forest area in a smooth and simple manner. This is because earlier when it was defined as a tree, the farmers required the permission of competent authority whether to fell the bamboo for transit purposes. Now it is not a requirement in non-forest area, whereas the legal requirements are still there for the bamboo in the forest area. Because of these requirements for permission and other restrictions in the forest area with respect to bamboo, several communities that depend on bamboo cultivation are in a disadvantaged situation when compared to the farmers who cultivate bamboo in the non-forest areas. Now, some of the tribal groups which are affected are the Kolam tribal group and the Naikpot tribal group in the states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. This is one side of the story with respect to the Indian Forest Act of 1927. But there is another side of the story, which is the act that deals with the scheduled tribes, which is called the Panchayat Extension to Scheduled Areas Act of 1996, in short called as PESA Act. There is a particular provision in this act which states that the panchayats in scheduled areas shall be endowed with the ownership of minor forest produce by the appropriate state legislatures. And there is one more act which you need to know, which is the Scheduled Tribes and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Forest Rights Act of 2006. There is a particular provision in this act, which is section 2I. This particular section defines minor forest produce. So this act states that minor forest produce includes all non-timber forest produce of plant origin, including bamboo, among other forest produce. Some of them are like brushwood, medicinal plants, and herbs. But by the provisions of Indian Forest Act of 1927, the bamboo-dependent communities are not able to enjoy their rights under the PESA Act of 2006 and Forest Rights Act of 2006 in the forest areas. This is because in the forest areas, they are having certain legal restrictions in felling bamboo. So they purchase bamboo from the state forest departments to make bamboo baskets and mats for their livelihood. Also, their traditional market is among the tribal group called as Raj Gaon tribal groups and other forest dwelling communities. And there are issues in marketing their products, which can be done by expanding their market to the other areas with government support. And there are also issues about diversifying the designs that are made by them for more profit, which can be done by appropriate training. So these are some of the issues that are mentioned in the news article. The authorities in the forest department are saying two versions. One is that the legal restrictions are still there under Indian Forest Act of 1927. And the other version is that the government is only against the extraction of bamboo through unsustainable methods. They are saying that the unsustainable bamboo extraction can be rectified through proper training of the local communities, and the Kolam tribal group will be allowed to cut bamboo in forests for traditional livelihood purpose. So these are the two versions of the forest department authorities. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about a recent study that was conducted by the World Health Organization, which is on the unintended pregnancies. This article is of significance because it speaks about the vulnerable section of our society, who are the women. And especially in a developing country like India, this report is of importance because it throws a light on how unintended pregnancies in women will push them into a vicious cycle of poverty and underdevelopment. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, this study by the World Health Organization covers the use of contraception among sexually active women, and it also discusses about the link between the increased rate of abortion and unintended pregnancies and the role of family planning. And this study was conducted in 36 low and middle income countries. We can define unintended pregnancies as those pregnancies that are mistimed and which are unplanned or unwanted at the time of conception. The most common reason for unintended pregnancy is unprotected intercourse. Now let us look into the important findings of the study. The most important observation is that 2/3 of sexually active women who wished to delay or limit childbearing stopped using contraception. It is to be noted that sexual activity is measured based on the frequency and the intensity of the sexual desire in men and women according to their age. Now, some of the reasons for not using contraceptions have been given in this report. One is the fear of the side effects of having contraceptives. Next is the health concerns. And next is the underestimation of the likelihood of conception. The report says that this resulted in the increase in the number of unintended pregnancies. And 1 in 4 pregnancies are unintended as per this report. It is to be noted that unwanted pregnancies are a part of unintended pregnancies. So an increase in unwanted pregnancies might lead to an increase in the rate of abortion. And unintended pregnancies, they are a wide range of health risks for the mother and child, such as malnutrition, illness, abuse and neglect, and sometimes even death. And if you see, unintended pregnancies can also lead to cycles of high fertility. In the sense, a woman can bear more children. And because of this, it will bring down the educational and employment potential of women. So this will push not just the mother, but the entire family into the vicious cycle of malnutrition, poverty and unemployment. Since these can also affect the overall development of the newborn, these challenges have the potential to affect the generations. So in this context, unintended pregnancies are an important public health issue. This is the reason why we are discussing this news article today. You can quote some of the impacts of unintended pregnancies in the relevant mains answers in your GS2 paper. Now let us see the global statistics that is mentioned in this report. This study by the World Health Organization says that globally, 74 million women who are living in low and middle income countries have unintended pregnancies every year, that is annually, and this leads to 25 million unsafe abortions and 47,000 maternal deaths every year. Here, the term unsafe abortions refers to those procedures which are used for terminating or ending an unwanted pregnancy, either by persons who are lacking the necessary skills or in an environment which lacks minimal medical standards, or sometimes both these. And maternal deaths are nothing but deaths of those women who carry the child. Next, this news article also mentions about data from a medical journal called Lancet on India-specific facts. It says that in India, abortions accounted for 1/3 of the overall pregnancies, and nearly half of the pregnancies were unintended. This study had estimated that in the year 2015, 1.56 crore abortions occurred in India. The abortion rate in India was 47 per 1000 women who were aged 15 to 49 years. It is important to note that all these abortions were not legal or within the health facilities. And according to this journal, 34 lakh abortions, that is 22% of the total abortions, were obtained in health facilities, and 1.15 crore abortions, that is 73% of the overall abortions, were medication abortions which were done outside of the health facilities. And 8 lakh abortions, that is around 5% of the overall abortions, were done outside of the health facilities using methods other than medication abortion. From this data, we can see the threat that is posed by the unintended abortions to the health and well-being of the mother as well as the child. So, how can it be prevented? The World Health Organization report says that modern methods of contraception has a vital role in preventing unintended pregnancies. Here, note that modern contraceptive methods include using condoms, then pills, that is tablets, and also using intrauterine contraceptive devices, in short IUDs. Then the study also highlighted the need for high quality family planning. In simple terms, family planning can be defined as a practice of controlling the number of children and the intervals between their births, mainly with the use of contraceptives. Note that family planning offers a range of potential benefits like improved maternal health, improved child health. Then it also has wide-ranging social impacts like educating women, and it also leads to their social and economic development and overall women's empowerment. The report also mentions several measures to bring down the rate of unintended pregnancies and its adverse impacts. First is to take a shared decision-making approach while selecting and using the effective methods of contraception that fits the needs and preferences of the clients, so that this will ensure that both the partners are well aware of the method of contraception. Next is the early identification of concerns of women and girls about the method of contraception that they are using. Here, the local health authorities has a crucial role to play. They can bring awareness about the different contraceptives, and they can make those contraceptives available, and they can also ensure ending the rumors about the side effect. Next is to identify and enable women who may have concerns about their method of contraception and wish to switch methods. Also, high quality counseling can be provided, which is free of any stigma, discrimination or coercion, so that this will ensure the rights and dignity of women and their reproductive intentions are respected, and at the same time their sexual health is also protected. And finally, it is also essential to improve the skills of the doctors, nurses and midwives through training and professional development, so that they can provide effective family-centered counseling to all the women who need it. So these are some of the methods of prevention. In this news article, we have discussed the increase in numbers of unintended pregnancies and the health risks that are associated in the low and middle income countries based on the World Health Organization report. One must note that if adequate measures are not taken to control unintended pregnancies, then women and children, who are the most vulnerable section in any country, will be pushed into the vicious cycle of poverty and underdevelopment. Let us move on to the next news article. Now see this news article. This news article reports that civil service probationers train at Statue of Unity. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. With reference to this news article, we'll be discussing about Aarambh, then about Statue of Unity, and finally about Rashtriya Ekta Divas. First, let us see about Aarambh. Aarambh, or beginning, is the common foundation course for the probationer civil servants of the 2019 batch. This common foundation course has begun at the Statue of Unity, which is located in Gujarat. around 500 newly recruited bureaucrats for various cadres like Indian Administrative Service, Indian Police Service, Indian Foreign Service, Indian Revenue Service will undergo 6-day training. And also seminars will be given by the field experts. And there is one more new initiative under this Common Foundation course, which is the mentorship program called Nurture the Future. Under this mentorship program, all the civil service officials will be divided into teams and they will visit villages near Kevadia, and each official will take a youth under him or her and will provide career and professional guidance. So this will ensure a better and brighter future for the youth who are living in the remote and rural areas in Gujarat. And this news article tells that over the next 5 years, this initiative is expected to cover nearly 1 lakh youth throughout the country as a part of the foundation course for the probationers who have cleared the civil services exam. This is in brief about this program. Next, let us see about the Statue of Unity. This Statue of Unity is nothing but the statue of Sardar Vallabhai Patel. It is the tallest statue of the world, which is about 182 meters. And this statue faces Sardar Sarovar Dam, which is located around 3 kilometers away. See, this statue stands on the isle, which means small island of the Sadhu Bet. This island is located on River Narmada. The exact location is Kevadia in the Rajpipla district in the state of Gujarat. Why this statue is named as Statue of Unity is because Sardar Vallabhai Patel took great efforts in uniting India post-independence. Hence, the statue is named Statue of Unity. Next, let us see about Rashtriya Ekta Divas. Rashtriya Ekta Divas in English means National Unity Day. It is celebrated every year on 31st of October. 31st of October is the birth anniversary of Sardar Vallabhai Patel, who is the Iron Man of India. Now, this day is celebrated to pay tribute to Sardar Vallabhai Patel for his efforts to unite India, so that such a celebration will help the youth of the country to be aware of the contributions of Sardar Vallabhai Patel. From this news article, we have seen about Aarambh, the Common Foundation course, then about the Statue of Unity, particularly its location, and finally about Rashtriya Ekta Divas. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. Now, see the first question. The question is, the Sakala mission, frequently seen in news, is, they have given four options. The first option is, it is a mission to improve nutrition standards of young children up to 5 years of age. And the second option tells that it is an e-governance initiative of the central government for retired army personnel. The third option, it tells that it is a proposed mission by the Indian Space Research Organization, that is ISRO, to launch Robonaut to outer space. And the fourth statement, it tells that it is a mission by the state government of Karnataka for guaranteed timely delivery of citizen services. Know that Sakala mission is based on a legislation or an act which is called as the Karnataka Sakala Services Act 2011. This act mentions the time period for each service that is to be delivered to the citizens. And the schedule of this act has a provisions for the stipulated time period for around more than 300 services in more than 40 departments of the state government of Karnataka. So the correct answer to this question is option D, a mission by the state government of Karnataka for guaranteed timely delivery of citizen services. If you see, there is also an appeal mechanism for the aggrieved citizens. Then there is the compensatory cost that has to be paid by the liable authority to the aggrieved citizen for the default or delay in any service delivery. And also monitoring of the status of the application is also available under this Sakala mission. And the recent news was that the Prime Minister of India had shown special interest on this mission of the government of Karnataka, where he has also thought about having a similar such mission for the citizen services at the national level. So the correct answer is option D. Now see the next question. The question is, the ease of doing business index is released by. This is a straightforward question because in few years you do get questions like a particular index is released by which of the organization. Here the correct answer for this question is World Bank. Know that the ease of doing business index is a part of doing business report which is released every year by the World Bank. So here option D is the correct answer. Recently, World Bank has released Doing Business 2020 report. In this report, India has been ranked 63rd out of the 190 economies that have been considered for ease of doing business ranking. So doing business covers 12 areas of business regulation. Out of these 12 areas, only 10 of the areas are considered for ease of doing business ranking. They are starting a business, dealing with construction permits, getting electricity, registering property, getting credit, protecting minority investors, paying taxes, trading across borders, enforcing contracts, and resolving insolvency. And the remaining two indicators, which are regulation on the employing workers and contracting with the government, are not included in the ease of doing business ranking. So the correct answer for this question is World Bank. And if you remember, in 2019, there was a question on ease of doing business index, which was regarding the sub-indices of this particular World Bank's ease of doing business index. Nothing but the indicators that we just saw. See the question. The question is, consider the following statements with reference to the particularly vulnerable tribal groups. They have given three statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements. Now look at the first statement. It tells that both the Kolam and Nagpur tribes are included in the list of particularly vulnerable tribal groups. Know that only Kolam tribal group is notified as a particularly vulnerable tribal group in three states, which are the states of Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Maharashtra. And also know that they reside in the states of Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh as well, along with the states of Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Maharashtra. But the Nagpur tribal groups are not included in the list of particularly vulnerable tribal groups. So the first statement is wrong. Now look at the second statement. It tells that the categorization of particularly vulnerable tribal groups is done by the Ministry of Tribal Affairs. This statement is also wrong, because the categorization of any tribal group as a particularly vulnerable tribal group is done by the Ministry of Home Affairs, not by the Ministry of Tribal Affairs. Now look at the third statement. It tells that one of the criteria followed for determination of particularly vulnerable tribal groups is moderately low literacy. This statement is also wrong. There are four criteria. The first criteria is that a particular tribal group must have a pre-agricultural level of technology. And the second criteria is that the population should either be stagnant or a declining one. And the third criteria is that extremely low literacy, it is not moderately low literacy. And the fourth criteria is that a subsistence level of economy. So this makes the third statement wrong as well. Now this question has asked you to choose the correct statements. The correct answer is option D. None of the statements are correct. Now see the next question. The question is, Statue of Unity, often in news, refers to. They have given four options. The first option is Rashtriya Ekta Divas. The second option is statue built on the Isle of Ken Betwa confluence. Then option C is given as a statue built in the honor of Sardar Sarovar Dam. And the fourth option is world's tallest statue built on the Isle of Sadhu Bet. Here the correct answer is option D, world's tallest statue built on the Isle of Sadhu Bet. See, the Statue of Unity was built in the honor of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. It is the tallest statue of the world, which is about 182 meters. And this statue stands on the isle, that is a small island of Sadhu Bet, which is located on River Narmada. To be exact, the statue is located at Kevadia in the Rajpipla district of the state of Gujarat. Here, just read the statements very carefully. Know that Rashtriya Ekta Divas is celebrated annually on 31st October to commemorate the birth anniversary of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. So the first option is wrong, and Statue of Unity is built on the Isle of Sadhu Bet on Narmada River, but not on Ken Betwa confluence. So the second option is also wrong. And this particular statue is located facing the Sardar Sarovar Dam, which is around 3 kilometers away. So it is not built in the honor of Sardar Sarovar Dam. So the third statement is also wrong. So the correct answer to this question is option D, world's tallest statue built on the Isle of Sadhu Bet. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.